Introduce and then, sir, we'll begin in a while, sir.
So we are live right now. So good afternoon, everyone. This is Pratyush Kumar Jena, a student of NUJS and the co-convener of the Society of Advancement of Criminal Justice. I would like to take the privilege of welcoming you all to the sixth e-lecture organized by the Society for Advancement of Criminal Justice. With us today, we have Mr. Kamal Mukherjee, sir, former additional IG of Correctional Services, West Bengal. Sir is presently engaged as an external faculty of RICA, Kolkata and Calcutta Detective Training Institute. Sir was also engaged as the State Public Information Officer for the Department of Correctional Administration, West Bengal. Sir has also acted as an advisor member of the Public Service Commission, West Bengal. While in service, sir was awarded prestigious President's Medal for Meritorious Service on Republic Day of 2015. In 2013, sir represented the state of West Bengal in the 33rd Asia Pacific Conference of Correctional Administrators held in New Delhi. Today, sir will be speaking on the theme of role of correctional officers in the criminal justice system. In these times where the effectiveness of the elements of criminal justice system has come into a debate, with the roles of correctional officers coming into question, we believe that views of sir, who has encountered every single element of criminal justice system in his illustrious career, hold immense significance. Sir, we are honored to host you. The moderator for today's session is Mr. Surjakanta Baladhikari, sir, faculty member at NUJS and also the faculty advisor of SSCJ. Mr. Baladhikari is an expert on the subjects of criminal law, victimology, and judicial access. Sir, we are thankful to you for agreeing to moderate this session. Now I'd like to request Surja sir to take over the session.
Very good evening, everyone. Thank you, Pratyush. It's indeed an honor to welcome Mr. Mukherjee, who has kindly consented to deliver this lecture. I, on behalf of our VC sir, as well as the entire faculty of NUJS, welcome sir on this online digital platform to deliver his kind address. But before we go ahead, there are some initial keynotes, one or two, which I would like to mention, and then I'll hand over the stage to sir. Correctional services is one of the most important stakeholders in the entire criminal justice system, which we often ignore when we deliver our lectures in the class or in the course. But sometimes the situations which we need to look into is the prison statistics, which often says that the growing population in the prison is a challenge. As per the data of 2018, the population which is there in the prison is 117.6% of the entire population, and amongst it, amongst 466,000 of the total prisoners, 323,000 are under trials, which is again one of the concerns in the present criminal justice system. And as per the section 436A of CRPC, which deals the law on the role how to govern or how to give bail to under trial prisoners, is often a challenge for the judiciary as well as the correctional services officers. We often know that the situation inside the correctional home cannot be always regulated by the rules which we read in the rule books. Sometimes it is all about the experience, how we handle the situation inside the correctional home. And we use the term correctional home. Rather, in West Bengal, we use the term Correctional Services Act 1992. So two words come into my mind: is rehabilitation and social integration, and how these things would be really a challenge. And with sir's enriched experience over the years in the correctional services, we would be really enlightened to hear him. Thank you, sir. I extend the floor to you now, sir.
Good evening, and thank you. Actually, I am very, very happy to meet you all. But future lawyers of this country, because I spent my 36 years of service period among these lawyers. be in the form of judges or lawyers in favor of prisoners or the prosecutors. Actually, the criminal justice system, this is collective name for the organizations of police, court, that is judiciary, and the correctional services. The correctional services, actually the entire goal of this system, this criminal justice system, is to bring the offender under this system, criminal justice system. Though a considerable portion of the prisoners are not always convicted, that means charges against them have not been proved, and it has not been proved that they are guilty. Still, it is the ultimate aim that if he is proven guilty, he should be brought under this correctional services system. Now, by going through the history of penology, we find that for years, and in the ancient period, it was the penology says that it was like tooth for the tooth, eye for the eye. The punishment was given by the captors when no organized law was made. Then came the system of law by the state. Even then, the punishments were harsh. Some of the punishments I would like to say that were financial loss from time to time. It was financial loss, restitution and reparation, imprisonment, which is a social degradation, removal from the group, reduction to a lower social status, enslavement, deprivation of privileges, banishment, and transportation, or physical torture. The capital punishments were beating, using mace to crush the head, beheading, burning, crucifixion, drowning, destruction by wild beasts, playing, hanging, impaling upon sharp sticks, is called sul in our language, in Sanskrit or Bengali. Precipitation from a height, stoning, strangling, hanging, electrocution, gas chamber, death by guillotine. These were the punishments which were being used during the early period. But it was found that in spite of all those punishments, the criminality did not reduce. So people started to thinking this alternative way. It became detention and fine is another system. But only by detention did not improve. Then came the concept of this correction in the modern times. Even if we find in 1952, even there was a system of playing in America, the champion for human rights. Even when I entered the service in 81, I saw the prisoners being handcuffed and put under link fetters. Two prisoners under single link fetter working outside the correctional home, and outside then it was called jail. It was this scene, very ignominious scene for a human being to walk like a beast outside among the people. The very ignominious for the person. Though he has committed crime, but to become a prisoner does not mean a person becomes a non-person. He is still a human being. Now came the concept of correction. This correctional home, which you are not very much acquainted. You are more acquainted with jails, I think. This concept of correctional home came first in West Bengal. It was in 2000, 14th April 2000, West Bengal Correctional Services Act 1992 came into force. And the jails are called correctional homes. And the jail service has been replaced by correctional services. In other states also, though the correctional home jails have not been renamed as a correctional home, they are still, it is called correctional service, prison and correctional services, because the word prison you cannot give up. You have prisoners, you see, of among the prisoners, 69.5% are under trials. And only 30.5% are convicts who come under the purview of the correctional system. You cannot enforce a person into the system of correction unless he is proven guilty. It will be an injustice for them, and he may protest that why I am not a delinquent. It has not been proven that a delinquent. And according to the law, a person proven to be a delinquent is an innocent person. Now comes the question that what are the process of correction we resort to? What is this correction? Actually, we first go into the process of correction to the working system. The court inflicts the punishment of levering, vigorous imprisonment. Mostly, the persons under serious capital laws like 302, 376, 395 APCs. That means murder, dacoity, or rape. They are inflicted punishments of rigorous imprisonment. So we have installed the work programs so that the prisoners, after being released from the correctional homes, they may return to the society as an useful member of the society. They may earn their living, and they can mix up with the mainstream of the society. What are these laboring programs we have? In Presidency Jail, for instance, we have phenyl manufacturing units, bakery units, and carpentry, MIDI. We have utensil manufacturing section, and in other jails also, similarly, in Gandham Central Jail, for instance, we have this taat, what you call weaving. In Mindapur Central Jail also, we are having weaving section. We weave the clothes of the prisoners there and supply to all the jails. And products, different type of products are sold from the jail depot. There is a jail depot below the writer's building. Now it has been shifted to Jessop building, Dalhousie. Products, different type of products like waste paper baskets, carpets, mats, dusters. These are being manufactured and sold outside. And it is expected that the prisoners, after they are being released, will earn something and will not be reverted to the crime for financial reasons. Apart from this case, we have from time to time introduced different levering, different traits, like in Hooghly District Jail, when I was a superintendent there, when we were having those what you call resam taat, called sericulture, with the help of the sericulture department. We are also having poultry there. The prisoners are being taught there how to rear the poultry. Then there is another system with the help of the community polytechnic system. That is, there is a community polytechnic cell of every polytechnic. The aim of this community polytechnic is to teach the persons less educated in vocational trades so that they can earn their living. We have introduced electrical wiring system, electrical repairing system to this community polytechnic cell in different jails or correctional rooms. Then there is another concept called this cultural therapy that has been brought in West Bengal in 2006. Under this system, it is believed that that a prisoner who is engaged in a cultural system would be corrected. Under this system, we introduced cultural therapy, and some NGOs came forward. Like you all heard the name of Mrs. Alokananda Rai. He came forward to teach dance, drama, dance to prisoners. And I can name one prisoner whom you have seen in the movie. That is Nigel Akara, alias Vicky, taking part as a hero in the film as in the Gotro. I think you have seen him in other movies also. He acted in other movies also. Because in Gotros, he had acted excellently. He was in Presidency Jail, and while in jail, he was taught this dancing, dance drama, and this dance drama group, this has earned a lot by performing on different stages in West Bengal, including Rabindranath Sadan, and different stages in West Bengal and outside the states also, in Delhi, in Mumbai, in Jharkhand, different states they have done under a minimum guard, and not a single person dead, because they are so involved in this cultural therapy system, and they have so loved this system that not a single person played this dead while journey from Calcutta to these places of Delhi and other states, Jharkhand, Mumbai, other states. They invited us and paid a huge amount. We have a prisoner's welfare scheme. The money is deposited in the scheme, and we help the relatives of the prisoners when they are in need from this prisoners' welfare fund. So this is another side, the victim. From victim side, actually whenever a person commits a crime, the offender is there in the jail, but the family is victim. The victim, if we compensate the victim, the offender is much less burdened. He becomes much relieved and starts thinking that he is being looked after. Apart from this dance, we are also having drama staged in different stages, like Taser Ghor by Pradeep Bhattacharya of Barampur. He acted in different films, you know, Pradeep Bhattacharya of Barampur repertoire. He teaches the business in the drama, and other also, there are also other in non-government NGOs, non-government organizations who have come forward to teach the business in cultural theater. Now, apart from this, inside of the prison system, we are having another system, that is probation system. You know, under sections 360 CRPC and under Probation of Offenders Act, there is a provision for releasing a prisoner under probation, considering his age, his character, his antecedent, and the circumstance in which the crime was committed. We have probation officers. Actually, it has been renamed as probation come aftercare officers, because he is not only looking after prisoners who are going under probation, but also the prisoners who have been released from the jail. His duty is to pursue them and bring reports that what they are doing now, and if he needs some help, we make him communication with the banks or different financial organizations so that he can start his own business or something like that with the help of the locations we already learned from the jail, a correctional home. So this probation officer is another correctional officer who works outside the correctional home. And before the prisoners are convicted, court takes a report from this probation officer, and orders for probation under his care up to a period of 3 years, which you'll find in the CRPC, that the probation he will remain under probation for 3 years. And there is also juvenile prisoners. You see that there is a provision in the jail code that no prisoners above the age of below the age of 16 for the boys and 18 for the girls cannot be lodged in jail. They are either left to probation or in juvenile homes. Juvenile homes are not run by the correctional services department. It is run by the social welfare department. Up to the age of 5, a child with the mother can stay inside the jail. And we are having education system for these children. We're also having education system for the convicts as a part of the correctional system, because you know education is the mother of all vocations. Unless a man is properly educated, he cannot even become a tailor. We have a tailoring section. Before he is inducted into a tailoring section or carpentry or whatever be it, he must have some knowledge of education. So education is the mother of all vocations. It is being taught inside the jail. Adult education system is there inside the jail. Prisoners are attending night schools inside the wards after they are being locked up. Apart from this, as I have already told, there are under trash business also. Constitute about 69.5% of the population. So our correctional measures is meant for this only 30.5% of these convicts. And apart from this, this 69.5% is under trial prisoners are there. We have to look after them. We have to detain them as per order of the court and regularly make them appear before the court, arrange the vehicles for them, treat them along with the convicts, render medical treatment, food, and other necessities. We have a panchayat system for the prisoners, which cater to the self-running system for the jail. There is a panchayat election inside the jails amongst the convicts of the jail. One prisoner, in case of central jails, some four or five prisoners are selected as panchayats. In case of district jail, one prisoner is selected as a panchayat. Looks after the welfare of the prisoners. This is what I can so far remember as a correctional measures. Now we can start the any question answer session which you like to.
Thank you, sir, for that insightful observation made by you. Sir, the first thing of also which is of my personal favorite, we are constantly thinking about the rights of the accused. Neither I am nor against the right of the accused. But when a parole application which has been extended or filed by the accused person, yes, how do we evaluate that whether the victim or the complainant in the case is at all safe if you release the prisoner in parole, and whether when the parole decision is taken, whether the voice of the victim or the complainant is heard or not, sir? Please.
Actually, I would, before going to into the matter of parole, I would like to go through another system inside the correctional rooms. As soon as a prisoner is admitted in the jail or correctional home, UT or a convict, a history ticket is opened for the prisoners, and he is regularly being watched, and his activities are recorded in the history tickets. In case of convicts, he is also granted remission for good work. Remission up to 1/4 of the sentence may be remitted. That means a person convicted for 4 years, he may be released after 3 years under this remission system. Up to a maximum of 1 year, 1/4 of the sentence may be remitted, and this remission power lies with the superintendent of jail. He regularly evaluates his performance, and on this performance, actually, we make this parole. Parole is given only to prisoners, only to convicts who are very trusted and who have been found to be very trustworthy, and minimum of 2 years of sentence. And among these 2 years, he has passed 1 year at least. Only then parole is granted. And we have not, we have hardly heard any mishap during a parole, excepting one prisoner so far I recall. One prisoner went to Purulia, and after that he could not be traced out. This is the only one system. He also belonged to the dance drama group of Valmiki Pratibha, which was being staged in different important stages. So he was not back. But other than this, lot of programs, lot of paroles are granted. These dramas and programs outside the jail these are also being done by granting parole to the business and under a minimum guard. And parole is after the parole is sanctioned, the prisoner is supposed to return in the scheduled date. If he does not return, the case is lost with the court. And in case of Kolkata, the CMM, the case goes in the court of CMM. And in case of district, it is CJ, judicial magistrate, who can punish him up to 3 years of sentence for this, for jumping this parole.
Sir, thank you.
And
sir,
another system, maybe I forgot to tell you, this also comes under purview of this correctional system. This is an open prison system. We have an open prison system in West Bengal and also in other states. Rajasthan having maximum 33 number total open prisons. We have one in Lalgola, one in Durgapur, one in Mindapur, one in Raiganj. These four open prisons are there. Among them, the Lalgola is having 100 capacity. Out of this 100, there are 20 cottages also to live, so that the prisoner can live with their family. Up to 5 members of the family can live with this, up to, that means 4 members along with the convict can remain in this cottages. So it is the pre-release trial. This parole is also a pre-release trial. Maybe accidents may occur, but it should not refrain us from taking the endeavor of returning the man into the society, the mainstream of the society.
Thank you, sir. So the next thing which you also mentioned in your lecture is about the plight of the under trials which they are facing in the jails. We know that the population in the prisons are ever growing from 113 to 115 and to 117 in 2018.
It is overpopulated.
Yes, sir. So what seems the real problem, and why can't we apply the law 436A of CRPC well? Is it the coordination between the local district legal services authority and the correctional services is the issue, or the issue of the panel lawyers, which is the issue, sir, and that is increasing the population? And we
actually whenever a convict passes this half of the sentence, under trials, this is meant for under trials, whenever an under trial passes this half of this 50% of this sentence, yes, he may be released on bail. So the population, so that the population may be reduced, and we submit before the court for releasing him. And if the state lawyer, he does not make the opposition, okay, then the court releases him. But in most of the cases, 436A has not been very fruitful. Some prisoners has already been released under this section, 436A. Moreover, I remember a section not relevant with, of course, with this 436A. There was a law, criminal, for detaining non-criminal lunatics, 13 Lunacy Act. Lunacy Act was there, prevalent. Till 87, it was prevalent. Before the Mental Health Act, 87, came into force, Lunacy Act was prevalent. And the prisoners, once he is held inside the jail under this Lunacy Act, the provision is there for keeping the prisoner for 30 days maximum. The prisoners were not being released. Now that stage is over. All the non-criminal lunatics have been released. Then comes the matter of criminal lunatics. I have seen a prisoner, while I was posted in the Damdam Central Jail, Damdam Central Correctional Home, that there is a system of file you called. That is, the superintendent supervises a portion of the jail, Delhi. He demarcates the, I used to demarcate the section in the five sections. And 5 days a week, I used to visit different sections and make query about the prisoners. One day, there were 3,000 prisoners at the time. One day, I came across a prisoner who was just sitting. His criminal lunatic ward was there. And I started make query about the prisoner. When I came back, the prisoner was not talking. He was sulky looking. He was just grouping. I made a query. And found the prisoner is detained there under section 379 for 42 years. Under 379, if he is convicted, maximum for 3 years. And he was there for 42 years. You know why? Actually, there, it happened before 42 years, he came to Sialdah station from Kuch Bihar, his native place. And he was arrested by the police and put up before the Alipur court. And Alipur court, he found him not fit to stand trial because he was talking irrelevant. And Alipur court ordered that the man should be sent to Alipur Central Jail. At that time, it was called jail, not room, Alipur Central Jail, and mentally treated. And thereafter, whenever he's fit to stand trial, he should be produced before the court. But during these 42 years, he never recovered. And he was inside the jail. Then when the man came to my notice, I started taking up with the court, Alipur court, and the judiciary then moved. That 42 years a man is inside the jail and he has not been released. Then he was taken to Institute of Mental Health at the time. Presently it is Alipur Women's Correctional Home, Alipur. It was previously Institute of Mental Health. That is under the High Court's order. A separate jail was made for the lunatics, from the non-criminal lunatics especially, that they should not be detained with the criminals. That's why the Alipur Women's Home was demarcated as a separate confinement. The man was ordered to be detained in Alipur Women's Correctional Home. Thereafter, he died there.
Thank you, sir. You very, very well showcased that how once the accused person is also now the victim of the present criminal justice system, and it is often, and it is also often due to the ignorance of not only the law but also the stakeholders which are implementing the law, which becomes the real source of the issue. We have adequate laws, but how we implement the laws?
We are having adequate laws, actually speaking to the law, not opening our eyes and ears.
Correct.
Keep our eyes and ears open, then also it helps the system.
So the next question which I would take up from Ms. Aditi, who is asking about the health issues or the health problems like depressive disorders, schizophrenia, any other disorders which the inmate face, and how the correctional services officers try to help out or to reach out to these inmates.
Actually, the law is that under Mental Health Care Act 2017, the prisoners who are mentally ill, they are supposed to be taken to mental hospital, not detained in jail. But under mental, but in jail, in every central correctional home, there is a special unit, and central correctional homes are having psychiatrists and psychologists also. They are regularly reviewing those prisoners. There are clinical psychologists in all the central correctional homes. There are maybe some jails are having vacant, post vacant, but there are posts created for clinical psychologists. And the clinical psychologists, they look after those prisoners. And there are regular psychiatrists also visit this prisoners and make the treatment. We initially try to send them to mental hospitals. And when, but it is very difficult to guard them in mental hospital. There is no adequate guarding system.
Thank you, sir. The next question is a very interesting one by Ratyush, and he says that what are the psychological effects of being a correctional officer? What are the challenges the officer himself feels or have psychologically when they handle these inmates?
Actually, the psychology of a correctional officer, this is very delicate.
Yes.
He is walking on a rope, because on one side, it is security, which is contradicting the welfare. So, he has to keep balance between welfare and security. And welfare is the prime object of the present day. Though the rules are in favor of the security, because only one prisoner escapes, the superintendent will be another ex. he'll be ex. But his duty is also to look after the welfare of the prisoner, so that he is committed, he returns to the society. So his psychology he remains very alert, and he is very alarmed. I think he's sometimes definitely very alarmed that whether this is human rights is violated. He is always under the scanner of National Human Rights Commission, State Human Rights Commission, Women Commission.
Absolutely correct, sir. Sir, in continuation of that, we have two more questions in continuation of that, asking by Nitin and Aditi, that as for the rights and safety of the inmates which are concerned, like you mentioned that we have to be very proactive about it and have to also balance the situation, what are the kinds of limitations which a correctional service officer often place to regulate and to balance a situation in a correctional home?
I'm giving first one instance, handcuffing. Handcuffing is one instrument with which we can secure the security of the prisoner. At least a violent prisoner, we used to handcuff. Now, under Supreme Court's order, handcuffing is illegal as a punishment. We cannot handcuff a prisoner as a punishment. We have to take permission from the court for handcuffing a prisoner, stating the proper reason. And that even for a specific period, we can resort to handcuffing. And link fetter has been totally abolished. I have seen prisoners under link fetters when I was in service. I entered in service in 81. But now it is no longer in vogue. No link fetter will be found in case. So a correctional officer has to be very, very, very alert, and very, his psychology is that always his a prisoner is committing suicide. For instance, this is another instance. A prisoner commits suicide. As per National Human Rights Commission directive, whenever a person dies in jail, it is to be considered as unnatural death, and FIR should be lodged with the local police station of an unnatural death. He should be first made a request, then postmortem, then a magisterial inquiry should be conducted. So every step in jail, because suicide is very common in jail. It's very common. A person who is bent upon doing suicide, it is very difficult to refrain him from committing suicide. It happens often, and whenever there is suicide, be it in the midnight, I was sleeping inside my home, at the comfort of home, at 3 p.m. say, at 3 a.m. say, the person has committed suicide, we have to run inside the home and see if he can be saved, or if he cannot be saved, his body cannot be touched because he has committed suicide. And a magistrate should be brought, and his body should be photographed and then brought down. An inquest of the body should be done. All these formalities should be done. So he is always at risk. And it also happened in the past that the prisoner dying in jail, criminal proceedings were started against the person. And if there is a shortage of, even there are complaints about food also. There are constant complaints of food also. Because the food is cooked, suppose 3,000 pizzas. Food is cooked for 3,000 pizzas in a Gangnam Central Jail, for instance. 3,500 prisoners are there. Food is cooked by the prisoners themselves. So it cannot happen that always all the prisoners will be satisfied with the food. If he is dissatisfied and if he complains before the visiting officer, there is always a judicial supervision over the jail now. Every week or every month, there is a judicial officer, either a CJM or district judge, they visit the jail. Makes the complaint, it comes under the scanner. And the superintendent has to reply. Superintendent has to raise that question that why it is being complained.
So the next one which we would take up is how far the correctional services has been effective to deal with habitual offenders, whether correctional services are really a success for the habitual offenders, or you see more and more often the same prisoners have committed the same offense or similar offenses, you see them back in the jail after they have served their sentence.
It is actually so. They commit the similar offenses and come back to the jail frequently. He comes back, we say, "Are tumi abar esecho? You are again in jail." This is very, very common scene in jail. But still, in this cultural therapy, we have seen some habitual prisoners, they are being corrected and they are working. All right, I have seen that. Some percentages there, but very few instances are there that the habitual offender has been corrected. Actually, the financial reason is there also, and there are also genetic matters regarding the habitual offender.
Correct. Thank you, sir. The next thing which we wanted to take is, like you already mentioned about that we being art and craft and all these things are already being taught to the inmates at the home. We have Pranita over here who is asking about that in Shimla, they have a practice to run a cafe by the prisoners who are serving their life sentences. To run a cafe which has been run by the prisoners who are serving life sentences. Is there such a similar thing which happens in West Bengal or something like that, sir?
No, in West Bengal there is no such enterprise taken. Once an enterprise was taken to run a petrol pump, the help of prisoners, but it has not matured. Did not mature at the time. But in other states there are, for instance, in Shimla, which was in Himachal Pradesh, they are doing this cafe system, all right. And in Tamil, in Telangana. This petrol pumps system is going on well because the prisoners who are serving fuel to the motors are these convicts from the jails. In West Bengal, it is no such a thing.
So I have two observations to make over here. I am aware that they also make very nice pen stands which are given as a token of appreciation when we go for delivering lecture at RICA.
Yes.
Made by the inmates. And also, sir, I saw in news that during this COVID situation, they are making these masks which are there and which have been distributed to the officers in the police service as well as the correctional service.
Yes. So this
I just came across.
I already have one mask in my home.
Okay.
They are making good masks. And
yes,
in Presidency Correctional Home, you are having a good tailoring section.
Yeah.
They are not only making masks, but also pants and uniforms of the staff. Uniform of the all the uniforms of the staff are sometimes made by these prisoners, convicts, tailors.
That's and interesting.
They are good fitting. Not that it will look like something. Something like that, not to be worn, but it is good, well fitted. So and also there is a jeans cutting. They also make the jeans cutting pen. Also okay. There. Okay. I purchased one. It is very good.
So with the objective of social integration and rehabilitation is also looked in this form as you mentioned or correctly pointed out, sir. So to take the next one, Vishal is asking about how do caste and religious prejudices impact the role played by correctional officers in prison? How do caste and religious practices or beliefs or thoughts do impact the role which correctional services officers play inside the prison?
Actually, this is a unique system in jail. Whenever a man is in jail, he is not differentiated in terms of caste or creed or religion. A man doing labor in a kitchen, he may belong to a lower caste or a upper caste. Doesn't matter. We change the labor. Next, after 3 months, we put him to gardening. After 3 months, we put him to smithy. We rotate them. So in jail, there has not been a single religious disturbance or problem due to casteism is not there. They forget everything there in jail. It's the unique system in jail. So why not make the whole country a jail?
Sir, nice observation, sir. So the next one which we take from Simran is that she's asking about that. Do you think providing correctional services officers with training pertaining to psychology is helpful in respect of managing inmates? A lot of questions which are coming on psychology and how their well-being are concerned. Along with that, I add one more question, sir, and then I'll request you. Shongomitra is also asking about that how to promote psychology and well-being for others, especially who are women inmates.
Psychology is very important for the correctional officer to know the psychology, to learn the psyche of the prisoners, especially if a person is suicide prone, if a person is gloomy, if a person is not responding properly. The person's psyche very important for the correctional officer. And for women prisoners, it is also so. Women prisoners, you must have proper psychological guidance.
Sir, is there any access to trained counselors or psychologists who attend?
There are counselors, NGOs counselors inside the jail. In all the correctional homes, we are having NGO counselors. They are regularly visiting the correctional homes, especially the central correctional homes, not the district or sub-correctional homes. The central correctional homes, they are regularly visiting and counseling the convicts and also the under trials. All the prisoners are being counseled. And if a suicide-prone prisoners are especially comes inside the prison, he's counseled. By the counselors. Counselors are there. In a woman correctional home, there are counselors. We have in one woman correctional home in Alipur, is having an NGO counselor is there.
Okay. So the next thing which we wish to take is from Prashasti. She is asking that what measures are taken to prevent the correctional officers from indulging in any corrupt or harmful practices at the behest of the inmates? What are the checks which are, or I know, sir, we all believe that they are carrying out their responsibilities, but certain aspects may come out. So what are the procedure to stop those things, sir?
Actually, regarding corruption, it cannot be wiped out unless the whole staff is all right. Actually, the corruption spreads to our staff also. Corruption among prisoners, because unless the guarding water staff who are in their immediate contact, they are motivated properly, you cannot wipe out the corruption from amongst the prisoners. Because prisoners, they are already, it is known that they are corrupt. They are actually just corrupt people. Already it is known. So if our guarding staff, they do not aid them, there is no scope of corruption unless our guarding staff aid in them in corruption.
Thank you, sir.
And it is corruption is there, and it is under supervision of the officers. Some corruption is under check, but corruption is there. Yes, corruption like stealing of food from the kitchen, corruption like entry of mobile telephone inside the correction homes. These are being taken inside the correction homes.
I heard that during my visit to the correctional home also that the complaint box is also kept there, and in the presence of the senior police senior correctional officer visit,
yes,
they also in front of them they can make a complaint or they can raise their things in before them. That is, I think, maybe practiced. I don't know, sir. You will be
These are the points of checklist of correction. Sir. Number one, the superintendent is bound to visit once in a week every prisoner. All the prisoners may represent himself instead of his superintendent. Secondly, the jailer, which is called chief controller now under the Correction Services Act in West Bengal, he is supposed to see every prisoner once a day. And thirdly, the superior officers like additional IG, DIG, and also in the district magistrates, and also the judicial officers like CJM and district judges, they are supposed to visit the correctional home. CJM and district judges, of course, visit not under the executive order, but under order of the High Court. They are supposed to visit the correctional home regularly, and they make the report to the High Court regarding the state of the officers. Prisoners are free to represent in front of them, and there are also complaint box, and there is one welfare officer inside every correctional home. Well, he's supposed to look after this.
Thank you, sir. So the next thing which we would like to talk about is that, can you please enlighten why prisons are not as receptive to technological advancement like the other pillars of the criminal justice system? Or do we have any kind of technological aspect which are in connection?
Technological aspects, we are having CCTV cameras. For security of the correctional home, we are having CCTV cameras in central correctional homes. And regarding the court production, it is made through the CCTV camera. We are having in Kolkata jails, we are having the video conferencing court production for the prisoners. These are the two technological things we are having.
What about their meeting with their family members, whether it is permitted by use of, because when I visited the correctional home, I got a thing that why can't a video call be allowed from the home or something like that?
This is also one aspect of correction which I forgot to mention,
sir,
that contact with the family,
sir,
is very important,
yes,
for correcting the man. Because it is very important. We allow them visit of the to meet them in the interview room is there, and they regularly meet the prisoners in the interview room. Of course, not during this COVID period, this has been restricted.
Yeah. Yeah.
There is telephonic system inside every central correctional home. There is a system of telephone. They can make certain number of calls at their own cost. They have to deposit the money with the correctional home. And with this, they have some 5 minutes or so talking period. They can talk with their friends and or relatives. But they have to give the names of the friends and relatives at the time when they register for taking the telephone facility. And they cannot talk beyond that. suppose they gave the names of three persons, they have to talk with those three persons specifically. And these telephone, these talks are covered, are recorded, and then later screened by the our officers. That if there is anything.
Yes. So the last question for today, we would with you like your permission would like to take that a lot of Dipanshu is asking that a lot of convicts would be having children, and when they are moved into the jails, their children also accompany them. Now, how challenging it is for the correctional service officer to deal with such kind of situations?
Children means children for the woman prisoner. Women prisoners. There is a provision in jail code rule in Correctional Services Act.
Yes, sir.
For allowing the children along with their mother up to the age of 5. Under R.D. Upadhyay case, the Supreme Court has also ordered that their children should be allowed up to the age of 5. They should be allowed to return with their mothers. And we are also having a provision for keeping the children along with the mothers in the female ward, only in the female ward, not in the male enclosure, and separate room for that. We are having schools for the children. We are having prayers somewhere. There is a provision for prayers, but it is not being run regularly. But under R.D. Upadhyay case, it has been ordered by the Supreme Court that every correctional home, every jail, should have a prayers for the children up to the age of 5. And we are having separate children born in jails. Sometimes children are born in jails also. Pregnant mothers are coming and children are born in jails. We are having separate system for that. Separate food is being purchased, and utensils and clothing are made arranged for those.
Thank you very much, sir. It was indeed a great, insightful session. I extend my warm regards to you, and thank you for agreeing to be part of our online SSCJ digital lecture, sir. Now I request formally one of the members of our society to formally extend the vote of thanks by Shreya. Please, Shreya.
Yes, sir. So I, Shreya, the co-convener of Society for Advancement of Criminal Justice, take this opportunity on behalf of all the committee members to extend our heartfelt gratitude to you, sir, for sharing with us your vivid experiences. So it was truly an enlightening session with you sharing with us your valuable experiences and insights while addressing the importance of the correctional services and by linking it with the criminal justice system of our country. So the mode adopted by you to deal with the concept while explaining us the intricacies and the foundational backgrounds, the pursuant acts and cases, the acts and provisions, and obviously the instances have really helped us make a greater understanding of the concept. And the discussion that have transpired have gave us a chance to ponder upon and understand the intricacies of the role that the correctional officers play in management of the prisons and the welfare of the prisoners. So at this point, I would also like to extend my gratitude to our faculty advisor and moderator of the session, Surja Kanta Baladikari, sir, for succinctly moderating the session and briefing us about the topic at the beginning of the session. So we are also thankful to you for your constant guidance and support, which helped us organize this session. I'm also thankful to the Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, and the faculty members of NUJS for the support that they provide to us. Lastly, I'm thankful to all the participants who came up with such quality questions that helped us make the session even more transpiring and engaging. Thank you so much, everyone who joined us today. This was truly an enlightening session, and we all are privileged to have interacted with you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, all the students.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. We hope to see you in the university very, very soon in the next semester, sir. Thank you.
I also expect so.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
See you soon in the other place.
Thank you, sir.